Hello and welcome to another episode of the Vegan Luna podcast. And in this episode, episode number 8, I sit down with the one, the only Diana, the owner of the Two Kind Bakery in Saudi Arabia. I had an amazing opportunity to come and get to interview her and sit down and talk about something that's very interesting. We talked about diabetes and how diet contributes to some causes of diabetes, and how Saudi Arabia is one of the leaders in the world when it comes to people with diabetes. And she does it in a very unique way that you might not think of fighting diabetes. She actually helps people fighting diabetes with desserts. Yes, desserts. We're talking scones, we're talking macaroons, we're talking tarts. And most people think that desserts is something that you cannot help diabetes with, and it's totally the opposite of what you might think. We talk about veganism, of course, we talk about animals, and I think that you guys are in store for an amazing episode. So here we go. Hello and welcome to the Vegan Luna podcast. I'm sitting here in Saudi Arabia, which is very surprising for veganism in general. Not a lot of people think about Saudi Arabia when it comes to vegans or veganism or healthy eating in general. And I'm sitting here with someone that is very, very special because they have a bakery where they do incredible desserts that are completely cruelty-free. They have no animal products of any kind. They're also healthy, sugar-free. And I was very lucky to have the opportunity to get to meet this individual and come into their home and record and do a podcast and a YouTube video with them. So I'm super excited for everyone to get a chance to hear from her. Her name is Diana. So Diana, go ahead, introduce yourself.
Hi, I'm Diana Dora, and I'm the co-founder of Two Kind Bakery. Which I founded with my mom, Lena, who is the chef and the origin of our bakery idea. So all our desserts are 100% vegan, gluten-free, lactose-free, sugar-free, and butter-free. My mother actually started experiencing and testing recipes a couple of years ago. And it took her around a year or two of testing before we actually could put our products
to sale. Wow, a year or two. That's some dedication.
Yes, because it all started with her wanting to do desserts that were good for diabetic people.
Wow.
Because they can't have sugar, they can't have what we can have, what normal people can have. And as she was researching, she started looking into veganism and not using any animal product. And that's when she realized it could be even healthier. So our desserts can be eaten by diabetics, by people who actually go to the gym and don't want to put on and who want to have a healthy, guilt-free dessert. And basically, this is how we started it.
Wow, that's awesome. So tell me more about why is it beneficial for someone that's diabetic, for anyone that maybe is diabetic listening? Like, why can you eat these kind of desserts? Maybe not just yours, but in general, in wherever they maybe live.
Yeah. So usually vegan desserts, since like especially ours, they're vegan and sugar free. So we don't use sugar. We replace it with natural sugars that we find in fruits or even vegetables.
Like dates,
like apples when you make them into
like a sauce.
Yes.
Yeah.
Like beetroot.
Yeah.
Like, for example, butter is replaced by avocado. She worked with a nutritionist to develop these recipes, and we tested them on diabetic people. And when they ate our desserts the next day, when they take the insulin level, it wouldn't go higher.
Wow,
it stayed at the same level.
That's the first time I heard of someone that would make like a vegan dessert or dessert that is especially for diabetic as well as doing the testing. Yes. So tell me more about the testing and how that worked. That's interesting.
So we tested on people from the family so that we don't put anyone else's life at risk.
Yeah, let's risk the family. Yes. That's okay. They'll forgive
the
us.
The cousins, the uncles, it's okay.
Yeah.
Because we have relatives that have diabetes, so it's common in our family. And so when the recipes, when the desserts were ready, we made them test it and take their insulin levels afterwards. And then we actually, our first clients were Kingdom Hospital in Riyadh, because like with the nutritionist and the doctors there, when they saw what we put inside, it's actually products that they could give their patients after surgery and the diabetics that are in the hospital.
Wow,
and
that's
from
amazing.
There, we started to spread to individuals, but we started at the hospital.
That's awesome. So, what typically in a typical dessert, like a ice cream, cookies, muffins, like the normal ones, right? That have dairy or eggs or lots of sugar. What's in there that really is not good for us or good for someone that's diabetic?
Well, you know that now, well, the sugar, first of all, and we've realized that with time, a lot of people are becoming lactose intolerant. Like, for example,
are they lactose intolerant or are they just not baby cows?
No, I think that the animal milk, maybe the cow milk, you have a lot of enzymes in it and
the hormones.
Yes, hormones, and it affects your stomach. For example, I can't drink. I stopped a long time ago drinking cow milk because it would make me sick.
Yeah.
So I don't know if it's only the lactose, but I think that there's something in the dairy products that we don't digest anymore.
Yeah.
And that they can eat because there's no sugar. This is the most important part.
Yeah.
And no butter. For example, you have products that replace butter, like avocado. Actually, a good way to keep everything like moisturized and, you know, with the butter effect is to use apple compote. Like, you know, when you boil the apple, you put cinnamon with it. It becomes... like a paste, actually, that and the dates you have. We always try to use natural products and organic.
Oh, wow.
Yes.
Nice. That's awesome.
We try, even though it's a little bit hard here.
So now that you, how long has the company been around?
It has been around for almost 3 years now.
Wow, 3 years.
Yes.
So how do you get your product out there and how do you market it? How do you tell people that you're here and how do they find you?
So we've created the Instagram account.
Uh-huh.
And actually, we in the beginning, we didn't really know how to expand. So like I said, we started at the hospital and it was more like with my mom, we would go to every single coffee shop in Riyadh or restaurant and like bring in our menu and make people test it and showcase our products. We tried to join as many markets as we could when there's events. And that's how the word started to spread. We have a couple of coffee shops that started buying from us. And
White Foam Cafe is one, right? I've been there.
White Foam was one of the first, yes.
Yeah. Is all the product in White Foam Cafe from you guys?
Yes. No, yeah. Not all of them.
Oh, some
only the vegan ones.
Yeah, the vegan ones. That's what
yes,
I mean.
Yes, only, oh, the,
only
vegan
the vegan ones.
Ones.
Yeah,
yes.
Yeah. I had some of those.
Yes.
Yeah, I had like the peanut butter cake.
Oh, yeah.
Was that one yours, right?
Yes.
And then the almond, one of the almond ones. It was like almonds, had almonds on top.
Yes.
What is that one?
Yes. Yeah.
That one's called?
The
tart?
It was maybe the pumpkin tart. No, the almonds on top.
Yeah.
Because we stopped making this one.
Oh, okay. Yeah. So that's the one I had. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. They were good.
Yeah. Yeah. But White Foam was one of the first. Yeah, that's true. And that's how, because it's next to the universities.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
So that's how then people would start calling and asking for orders. So we started to make deliveries.
Oh, nice.
And we're, anyone can order from us now.
Wow. So is it become a full-time thing?
Yes.
Yeah?
It has.
Nice. That's awesome.
That's good, yes.
How are people enjoying the food? Do they feel like they're not losing anything when they eat your type of desserts?
Well, being a huge sugar lover, I always, when they ask, when they, because sometimes we ask, sometimes we have clients that don't know what to order. So they ask for advice, and like that's one of the reasons why we called it Too Kind, because my mom will take the time to talk to each and every one of them. And what I always tell them is that if you're used to having a lot of sugar, then take the chocolatey desserts or yeah. the banoffee, because it's caramel and but it's not like, I didn't feel that big of a difference between the vegan and sugar-free ones and the others, because it's pretty it's still consistent. It's
so how do you make some people might not realize, how do you make chocolate desserts?
So we use, of course, pure cacao. And to make it maybe less it's because the cacao is very it's not sugary. It's not sweet at all.
Yeah.
So we use coconut milk,
Oh, nice.
Almond milk, and then there are other things that make it sweeter and make it taste like real, like normal chocolate cake or.
Do you feel like desserts. Making like chocolate like that is challenging, or is it?
Well, not anymore. It was challenging in the beginning, but now it has become second nature. It has yeah. become something, and they're not very complicated to make.
Yeah.
It's easy to make. It's the dosage that's very specific, because if you mess up, and I think in baking generally the
baking
dosage
is it's like very specific. It's very, like a science.
But when it's vegan, I feel it's even more specific, because one thing more than the other changes the consistency, and since you want to keep the same consistency as the normal dessert, you have to be very specific.
So what kind of desserts do you offer? What kind of things do you have?
So we have we offer almost the same as normal desserts. That's our goal, was to not have it to not be vegan and healthy and different.
Yep.
We wanted it to keep, like, for example, here you have macaron. We were able, this took a lot of time to develop, but they're like normal macaron. And we do lemon tart, we do banoffee pie, we carrot cake, date cake, chocolate mousse, chocolate tart, the crinkles, chocolate crinkles. Wow. We do really like strawberry tart, mango tart, anything that you can find in a normal bakery.
Wow, that's awesome. So tell me about what we have here.
So here you have one raspberry macaron, one lemon macaron. We have one here, they call it amaretine. It's apricot, dried apricot, and you know they make a paste out of it. Chocolate and vanilla, and you have a chocolate mousse, which is my favorite.
So this, where does the macaron come from? That's French, no?
Yeah. Yes. Well, my mother is French.
Awesome.
And my father is Lebanese. And I think it's our background culture that made us want to do, like, we went into refined, maybe a little bit more refined desserts, because, like, it's the French touch, I'm guessing, from my mom.
Yeah.
And having lived, like, she's born and raised actually in Senegal. And she met my father in Paris.
Wow.
Where I was born a couple of years later. And so I think this, because, you know, you have the Middle Eastern touch with the amaretine, and we also make date macaroons. We try to put a little bit of our culture in each one of them.
One great thing is no cholesterol. Because there is no cholesterol in plants. But I'm interested in the saturated fat. Where is that one coming from? Is that coconut oil?
Yeah, you have the coconut.
The coconut oil.
Yeah.
So I'm going to try one. So this is a chocolate one?
Yes.
Yeah? All right. So this is my first time trying one. So let's see. Oh, my God. It's so soft.
I think the texture is the same as the normal macaron that you can find.
It's amazing. It's really good.
Really?
It's better than I expected. Seriously.
Really?
Yeah, it's so good. These are dangerous. Luckily, these are safe. These are healthy.
These are healthier,
right?
Yes.
And this is the chocolate mousse?
Yes. And as you can see, we put we always put the calories for each one of our desserts and the nutrition facts.
Yeah, that's awesome. Yeah. And it's good to see, like, especially a lot of people that are watching their cholesterol.
Yes.
You know, I had this one person that was talking to me about cholesterol, and they were like, I stay away from oil, but they're eating all kinds of meats, a large amount of meats. And I was like, why don't you stay away from that? Oh, well, that's too hard. I'm like, you know, it's...
But it rises the cholesterol.
It's what's important for you. Yes. You know what I mean? He needs one. Hey, puppy. We have a dog here.
Yes. And by the way, we can give her from our desserts, from the cookies that we make, because they're sugar-free. Okay, and so for animals...
Which one does she like?
I don't know. She just wants anything right now. Anyone? At this point, it's any.
All right. So these are amazing. Thank you so much. I really like them. Actually, like, I'm not joking. Like, those are better than I thought.
Good. We're happy.
And you could definitely tell that they're not sacrificing anything, which I think is great.
Yeah.
You know, you can get the healthy, the lack of cholesterol.
Yes.
All right. What should we do? Give her all of them?
No.
No puppy.
Oh my God.
All right. And then... and most importantly, especially for me, there's no animal cruelty.
No.
And I think that that's really, really, when you look at the word vegan, that's what it means. It means to cause the least amount of harm as practically possible.
That's true.
Right? So there might be situations, and people say all the time, oh, what if you were on an island, right? And there was a pig and you had, like, or whatever, a cow or a chicken or whatever, you know? We're not in that situation today.
That's true.
Even in a place like... here, we're in Saudi Arabia, we're in Riyadh, and when I walk into the supermarket, there's plenty of vegetables. There's plenty of fruits, there's plenty of beans, there's plenty of lentils, there's plenty of rice, legumes, pasta. There's enough, you know, to definitely get you by as far as what your nutrition needs, you know, depending on each person and what you're looking for. So I think that in today's day and age, it is definitely practical. You know, for someone to go, especially in most parts of the world.
That's true.
So speaking of that, in Riyadh and in Saudi Arabia, I'm interested to know a little bit more about the health situation within Saudi Arabia. We were talking about that. Can you share more about that?
Okay, so as I was saying, my mom did a lot of research in the beginning, and it all started with diabetes. And so while she was researching, she realized that... Around Saudi Arabia is part of the top 10 countries of the world with highest diabetes rates among people. Like, plus around 72, between 72 and 73% of Saudis over the age of 40 suffer from diabetes.
What? How much percent?
Between 72 and 73 over the age of 40.
Oh my gosh.
This is a huge number.
That's outrageous.
This is very big. And from these numbers, you have 18% of Saudi children that suffer from obesity. So, and my mom has always, since we were very young, well, she never cooked with butter and a lot of oil. She was always very healthy. And even when our friends would come over or people would come over, she would always make desserts and they were delicious, but she wouldn't even put sugar or butter in them. And we didn't know.
Wow.
So since we're young, she has this, I think she really cares about that. And so that's how it started. I think it's, we need to open people's eyes to that. Like, when you're a kid, you can't just... you know, drink Pepsi or Coca-Cola or have any kind of candy. It has consequences on the health.
Yeah, I even see kids nowadays eating, especially in the U.S., hot dogs and hamburgers and those sort of things. And you can see the direct link to the diseases, you know, from that.
Yes.
And one thing, I'm not a diabetes expert, but one of the things that I learned about diabetes through documentaries and watching things about health and studying nutrition as well. I do study nutrition.
Okay.
I'm studying to become a nutritionist, so I'm not there yet. But one of the things that I learned is how, especially type 2 diabetes, a lot of the times the fat that you eat will block the cells where the sugar is supposed to get inside. And what that means is that it's not only the sugar. So your body is producing the right amount of insulin. It's doing its job. But what happens is the sugar can't get into the cells. So when you test your blood sugar, blood sugar. And so you think automatically, oh, well, I got to stop the sugar. But you're not realizing that the cells are getting blocked with the fat.
So it's not the only food. The sugar.
So it's a combination. Yes. Yeah, it's definitely a combination. So if potentially, you know, if someone was, then that's why typically ones that are overweight typically have diabetes because their cells are getting blocked, right? From the sugar, especially type 2 diabetes.
Yes.
And so it's definitely a combination. And even on a vegan diet and plant-based diet, I've seen people that get reversed. This isn't science, you know, you could look at the science and look at the research and the studies if you want. But this is anecdotal, which means it's just a story, right? One of my really good friends went vegan about a couple months after me, not related to me, just on his own, doing his own research. And he was about 150 pounds overweight. He was a big guy. Mm-hmm. And he lost 100 pounds after going vegan after several months.
Oh, wow.
And he cured his diabetes, which to me was amazing.
It doesn't surprise me.
Yeah, that's my diabetes story as far as a friend, like a direct person that I know and watched how he went through. And I was just so proud of him and amazed. And now he's just like, when you go through something like that and you did it, especially going vegan and you think that could be the answer to your health issue. When the doctor said, you're going to have this forever, you're going to take insulin forever. There is no cure.
It's a lifestyle. You have to change your entire lifestyle.
Yeah. When you hear that from the doctors and then you cure it, you immediately have distrust. That's what happened to him. So he started to distrust, you know, certain things that doctors would say. And that's natural. If someone says you'll have this forever and they're pushing a very expensive insulin in the U.S. is outrageous. Wow. It's so expensive. And so when the doctors are pushing that, you start to question.
So again, you know, what's their motivation?
Yeah, you start to question the motivation. Do you want me to be better or do you want to make money off of me? Like, where's your motivation? And so for him in particular, he is very active now as far as veganism, you know. He's so funny. He has all these tattoos, you know. He's like, he lives in Southern California.
Okay.
And he has like these vegan tattoos on his knuckles, you know. And he's just, he's all about it. And it makes sense, you know.
Yes.
Whatever stigma or whatever belief you have about veganism, if you switched your lifestyle, you know, and it helped cure a disease that was probably going to kill you.
I mean, veganism changed his life.
It changed his life.
Yeah. In his case.
That doesn't mean, I'm not going to say that I can change every single person. But what I always recommend for every person, do the research.
Yes.
At least look it up and look at the other alternatives. If the doctor says this is option one, look for option two or three.
Always try to find something else.
And doctors are there to help. They're not there to hurt you. Like, their goal isn't like, hey, I'm going to make as much money. But they do have to get a paycheck.
Yeah.
They do have to make money. The pharmaceuticals do pay their paycheck.
Yeah.
That's where the money comes from. And the second thing is they're not trained in nutrition. Mm-hmm. So a lot of people think that you get nutrition advice from your doctor. But especially in the U.S. for sure, and most places in the world, the requirement of nutrition education is very low. It's an average about 8 hours in 7 years, right?
Oh, wow.
So if you look at what they're actually learning, they're learning to practice medicine. And medicine can help a lot of things, but not everything, especially with the diseases that we're dealing with today, the heart disease, the diabetes, some of the cancers, right? Some of those are really lifestyle related and nutrition related.
Yeah, they're nutrition. I feel everything is nutrition related because, you know, even when you want to lose weight, the most important part is not even the training part.
Absolutely. It's like 80%, 90% yes. nutrition. Yeah.
It's the nutrition, because you can work out as much as you want, but if your nutrition doesn't follow, then it's useless.
Yeah.
Or vice versa. So
yeah.
I really believe that nutrition is the most important element.
So you live in here in Saudi. What are some things that people are, what are some of the beliefs about food and the beliefs about diet that the most people have, or maybe that they see on TV or that they hear in the radio, wherever they get their information?
You know, wherever the idea of diet is, an, like everywhere, automatically people think of no more eating. When actually it's the opposite. When you diet, you actually have to eat, if not even like, and I hear a lot now about the intermittent fasting or... but I feel for me, what works for me and in being healthy, I eat around 5 times a day.
Yeah.
Like three
same.
Good meals same. And 2 small snacks.
Yeah.
And since I turned to veganism, I've been feeling a lot lighter, less bloated. I'm digesting my food better, and I feel good. I have to say, I really feel good about it. And I just don't want people to keep this idea of dieting as in, you know what, we have to eat as much meat as we can, but maybe once a day, or just stopping everything. Because your body, you know, like we said, it's a lifestyle. If yeah. when you do something on the long term, it will last. But, you know, stop eating, you will go back to eating, and your body will, it yeah. will come back negatively on your body.
Yeah,
so absolutely. I think that it's, like we said, it's a lifestyle, you know, it's something the same way, for example, you were not vegan, you can actually be vegan. It's just a habit. It's yeah. just something to change.
Do you think people think that they need meat? Like the eating animal products, like if you don't eat meat, you might be missing something. Do you think they think that?
A lot of people do think that. I think especially in the Middle East still, we think that having chicken or meat is the healthiest, and we need it to grow to be healthy. But at the end of the day, we've seen studies. I don't have the numbers, so I'm saying according to what I've read, that, for example, red meat is not healthy for the body, the fish, eating a lot of fish and with the mercury poisoning. So I feel there is a reason why maybe our bodies are not responding. And we've been discovering that the lifestyle we had, our food habits were very bad. And, you know, to go back to sugar, I just thought of something, you know, like for animals, like because the dog is right here. Like if they eat sugar, you know, they get diabetes, they lose their eyesight.
Yeah.
So I'm thinking if something is not good for animals or nature, then automatically it can't be very good for us.
Yeah, for sure.
I mean, if we want to compare.
Yeah.
But I think it's a mentality change that we have to work on. And the veganism is really growing here in Saudi Arabia and Riyadh. Since I live here, I know more about Riyadh. But we still have, you know, it's still, I feel it's still not accessible to everyone.
Yeah.
But like the cheapest, for example, the cheapest food they can buy is chicken and rice.
Yeah.
And it's one of the traditional.
In like a restaurant, right?
Yes.
Yeah.
So I feel that automatically they don't look at vegetables, because, you know, if you don't have a lot of money, you're going to put it in proteins. Maybe for them, it's a way of seeing things differently.
Yeah.
So I think maybe it should be more accessible,
yeah.
more try to make people more aware of the effects of it on the body, on the health.
Yeah.
But it's hard to change mentalities.
Yeah, I think that you're absolutely right. What you're talking about is convenience. And
yes.
what I always notice, like the more that I talk to people and the more that I help advocate for animals and the
yes.
lifestyle, and because I believe in it, is that there's 4 main reasons why someone has a very strong resistance towards making that change.
Yeah.
Okay. One is taste. Okay.
Yes.
If you don't have the right taste, or it doesn't taste good, or isn't full of taste, that you enjoy, you're not likely to continue eating it because taste is very important.
That's true.
And what's interesting, and I find out, especially when it comes to animal products and meat products, is most of the seasoning and the spices, they all originate. Is what gives it taste, and it all originates from plants.
Yes.
If you can get that same texture and that combination and use the same spices, you're going to get the same taste.
But
that
like, even if you boil a chicken without spices, it smells
like,
really bad.
And it tastes
and
like
you
nothing.
Can't eat it. Yeah.
And it tastes like nothing. Yes. Or imagine like a real carnivore.
Yes.
Right? Eating the chicken raw. Right? Exactly.
You can't salmonella.
It sounds crazy, right? And there's a reason why.
You have a lot of diseases.
Maybe we're not supposed to eat it, right?
Yeah.
That's what I think. But so taste, right? If you get the taste right, that's important.
Yes.
The next one is a convenience. So you talked about convenience.
Yes.
So making it convenient. So if it's tasty and it's convenient, you're more likely to get it.
To get it, yes.
Right? So it's in all the supermarkets, or it's in the restaurants, or it's very easy and to get, right?
Yes.
And the third one is culture. Okay, so if it's within your culture and you're like, well, this is my culture and this is my tradition, right? Culture and tradition kind of
yes.
go hand in hand. So culture, right, doesn't always dictate morality, mm-hmm. right? And same with tradition. There's things that we've been doing for thousands of years that weren't okay,
yeah.
right? Like in the U.S., for example, there was a time where we used to own slaves.
That's
right?
True.
And that doesn't make it okay just
yes.
because it happened thousands of years ago or we were doing it for a long time. Now, that doesn't mean that eating animals is the same, but I'm saying something being done for a long time doesn't always mean that it's okay.
And that's
right?
true.
Same with culture. There's certain cultures that mutilate the women,
yes.
right? Or even in Saudi Arabia, what I notice is the women are treated differently,
yes.
right? The dress that they have to wear and that sort of stuff. So I don't know all the specifics,
yeah.
Just based on what I see.
It is opening up.
It's opening
it's
up.
It's
yeah.
opening up. Like now, the abayas, the dresses.
It's like
we
not
have
required.
To wear more colored.
Yeah.
And we leave them open.
Yeah.
It's better. Like it feels good to see a little bit of color.
Yeah.
Again.
Yeah, for sure. It's never
because
just black.
It's always black and white.
Yeah, black and white.
But I feel it's opening, and in the vegan groups here, I see a lot of women, and they're really active and. Women are strong here, and they're rising. They really want to. They prove. They like at work. You know, since they started changing the laws and everything, we have more women that are working now. And since you know they feel they have more to prove, they actually do a better job than most men.
Yeah.
So I feel it's changing, and it's good for them. You know, it's good for them because at the end of the day. The world needs women as well.
For sure. No, the more you'll watch my stuff and watch my content, I'm a huge like pro women's rights.
Yes.
I believe that women will save the world. I really think so. I think that most women are more compassionate. I think that they're more caring. They're oftentimes don't get quite as the strong emotions as some men do as far as the anger and the violence.
Yes.
You don't see that very often in women.
Yeah.
And I think that if you look at all the issues in the world, they're not caused by women.
That's
typically.
True. I've never seen it that way, but I like it.
And,
I like your point of view.
And my wife, for example, I'm always pushing her to be more strong, more
yes.
independent, like you can do more. I like to push her.
That's amazing.
Not in a negative, like pushing way, but in,
yeah,
a,
yeah,
in
but
an
you
encouraging
support
way.
Her.
In a supportive way. Like if she wants to do something, like, let's do it. You
yes.
know, let's do that. That's a great idea. Should we work together? Right now we're starting
good.
A business together.
Very good.
It's very new, so it's about a 1 month in, but
okay.
it's I'm starting a digital media marketing
okay.
Company where I'm going to take over social medias of vegan businesses.
That's
and I'm going to help
very
promote.
Interesting and smart.
I'm going to help promote.
Still doesn't exist.
I'm going to help promote them and help. Basically, I'll take over the social media. I'll charge them like a monthly fee.
Yes.
Right? And then I'll help spread their awareness. And
promote
I have a,
their products.
I have
maybe,
exactly.
Or,
their products.
Okay.
I'll do their Instagram, their Facebook, their YouTube, their Snapchat.
Around the world or only
around
the
Middle
world. East?
Okay. Around the world. Yeah, exactly.
That's
so I have one client right now in Kuwait. And so
okay.
we're building the foundation. I have a team of 12
okay.
right now. So we're I have like someone for Instagram, someone for Facebook. I have
amazing.
Like an accountant, an analyst. So we're doing a lot of good work there to help
good.
Spread the awareness. What I believe is one, more people need to try good vegan food.
Yes.
The more good vegan food people try, the more likely they're gonna eat it. Second, yes. The more profitable and beneficial the vegan business is, the more they can expand. That's the true. More they can grow.
And the more they will bring people right? to taste them.
And then that means the more people are tasting. And that means the less animals that are getting killed. Yes. Right? So I feel like I can make a big impact yes. through marketing digitally because I can do that anywhere. That's all right. I'm not limited to just my city.
Yeah. And now with technology, everything is international.
Exactly. So you can do this worldwide.
Yes.
And so that's my goal. So okay, I'm building right
amazing.
Now. That's amazing. Yeah. So that's like my
You have all
side
our
project.
Positive energy. Yeah. Too.
That's my side project right okay. now. But I'm going at that like 110% right now.
Yeah, you should.
Most of my time I spend is focusing on building that business.
Yes, I think you should. It's a great idea because as vegans, as a vegan business, we need more people to promote us, to help us spread the word, to help us maybe have access to areas or people that can't really hear about us. So yeah, I think it's a very good idea. What you're doing.
Yeah, so the last thing I want to talk about is what do you feel like, in your opinion, that you're currently doing to help animals? And what I mean by that is the true definition of veganism is to cause the least amount of harm to animals.
Yes.
So what do you do that helps cause less harm to animals?
Well, first of all, as veganism, we don't use any animal product. Any. And, well... We love animals. I mean, as you can see, you walked into our house, there are cats, dogs. So the most important, like it started with a small thing, like it started with diabetes. But, you know, as when you go along and you start doing a lot of research, you realize that you can help so many people and you can actually help the planet because going vegan is more sustainable since you don't harm animals. You don't have like... I the meat production, the
greenhouse gases,
yes,
the pollution,
everything,
the rainforest, deforestation.
Everything is linked, and like we only started with diabetes, and now we are talking about the entire ecosystem,
yeah.
Because plants and animals, everything is related. So when you start one thing, like we went from diabetes to going healthy, to going sugar free, to going vegan. To realizing that going vegan is the healthiest path, that we're helping the animals, we're helping the planet, we're helping. I wish you feel sometimes that what you do, you don't really see how it impacts, but we have to keep doing it. We have to keep believing that at some point it will impact. And like, even if we, every new client we have who orders, we're happy. For us, it's like, one gain. It's moving forward and towards maybe bringing in more people and
in a better world.
In a better world, yes. Because it's what's happening to nature. And every time I read about an animal being extinct, it's really
like
sad.
They're saying 250 per day
it's
are being
really
extinct.
Sad. Or like the ocean becoming garbage.
Yeah.
This hurts. This is really something... that makes you mad.
Yeah.
Because it's something that we could have...
prevented.
We could have prevented. I mean, there were other ways of... I'm sure there were other ways, but the easiest way, for example, was to throw everything in the ocean.
Yeah.
Thinking it will never come back.
Yeah.
But like, they always say like what you give to nature, nature will return to you.
Yeah.
So, and we didn't really treat it well and give it...
Yeah.
Something good. So I guess it's turning on us lately.
It is, yeah.
And that's sad. That's really sad.
So what do you... Tell me about some of your animals and the story behind them.
So, okay. The dog that was barking right now because she wanted a macaron, she's actually my husband's dog. He's uh-huh. had her since she was 2 months. And the other dogs, we have another dog that we got from the Riyadh shelter we adopted. It was a dog that was hard to be adopted. He's already 3 years old. He's been abandoned 3 times. So, but you know, it's crazy because when we took him in, you feel that they need love. you feel that he's afraid of being abandoned again.
Yeah.
They do have that. I think animals really talk to you in a way.
Yeah.
The 7 or 8 cats that we have outside in the garden are all rescued. One of them I found in a car engine.
Oh my gosh.
I had to call the neighbors and check whose car it was so that nobody turns it on and so that we can try to remove the cat.
Wow.
One of them, actually, she had her leg broken and it healed in a very bad way. I took her to the vets here and they told me there was nothing we could do for her. She's going to grow like this. She's staying this way. But I've seen a lot, like I watch a lot of videos, you know, related to animals and everything. And I started giving her physiotherapy. Like I made her walk in water. I took a bassinet, put it water, and every day I would let her walk in it. And you didn't even realize it's the brown one, the one you is the eldest one here. And now she walks normally. You don't even realize that she has a small lump.
Oh my gosh, that's amazing.
So yeah, and the others are... whatever I find on the street, I bring back. And sometimes some of them stay, some of them leave, some of them come and go. I feel it's like I want it to be a safe place for them. They can come and go. And my mom loves animals as well. We always grew up with animals around the house, especially with her living, having grown in Senegal.
Mm-hmm.
They had a lot of animals there.
Yeah. Why do you think that, like, of course you have dogs and cats and the majority of people love dogs and cats as well. Why do you think people separate dogs and cats and the ability that they have to love, that we feel that they love us, they miss us, they care for us. Sometimes we feel like they need us, like what would they do without us, you know? That why do we feel like that these are the only animals that can feel that when it's like cows, pigs, and chickens?
All the animals.
That some people don't think that they feel that. Is it just a disconnect in their mind? Is it just that they haven't had spent time with those animals? What do you think it is?
I think it's because they've grown to, you know, they've grown in the culture or the habit of eating them. So as soon as you put a name on an animal, I think it makes it really hard to see it as food.
Yeah.
And I mean, in the Middle Eastern culture, you know, you don't learn to, first of all, you don't see cows and pigs or chicken the same way. For example, in France, we would go to the farm, you know, for like when we were kids, so we would see them.
Yeah.
But I think it makes you get closer because then... you have to put them in the same category as cats and dogs because they react the same way with their offsprings.
Yeah.
The mama cow will do everything she can to protect her baby.
Yeah.
And they feel fear. They feel, you know, I've seen videos in the slaughterhouses, the cows are panicked.
Absolutely.
Because they know, they're aware of what's happening.
They can smell, they can hear, they can see.
They know it. Animals are not dumb at all. They know what's about to happen. And you see, they are panicked. It's heartbreaking.
Yeah.
Or what they do to chickens. It's very hard to watch and to see these. But I think it has to start at an early age.
Yeah.
It really has to.
For sure.
Because, you know, but... Yeah, you have to see it this way. It's at an early age that it starts. And I feel even, you know, in children's books, we had books, you know, about the three little pigs, about the farms.
Yeah.
But I don't know if in the Middle Eastern culture is as much, I don't really know how, what they watch, how they grow up. But I mean, to have like 18% of children obese.
Yeah.
So it means...
I feel like if you were to show children exactly where their food comes from...
I don't think they would eat it.
They wouldn't eat it. Like if I were to show you like how you grow a carrot, you know what I mean? Or some broccoli.
Yes.
Right? I mean, or some beans or some rice. You wouldn't be horrified.
Yes. And then you show me what they do to a cow. I would be traumatized.
Exactly.
As a kid, I don't think I would eat. Like here, you know, being... because my father is Lebanese and we would go to Lebanon or even here. You know, they have... a holiday where they slaughter the
goat?
Not the goat, the sheep.
Sheeps.
Yeah. And when we were kids, like, I never ate sheep in my life because I would scream and cry when I would see them doing that. I would really be screaming and crying, and my sisters and my brother as well. So it's something that really shocked us, and we never ate sheep. That, like, before becoming vegan, we never had sheep because we've seen this.
That tells you something.
So, I mean, it does affect you.
It tells you something,
right? If you see cows, like, if I would have seen probably cows, I would have turned vegan at 5 years old, probably.
Yeah, I think there's a reason they don't show us that.
Yes.
Because they know that, we don't naturally want to see that, you know? And then when you start seeing the diseases, you start to see the dots lining up.
Yes.
You know? And, so I think that's very interesting. I mean, of course, in, you know, U.S. culture, growing up as kids, we saw the kids' books that you talk about, you know, the Three Little Pigs, and we always loved animals. I mean, I had dogs, I had cats, the neighbors had horses.
Yes.
It was just a very common thing. And then you sit down and you're just like, here's some chicken, here's some burgers, you know, and you don't ever ask any questions.
No, you don't.
I never asked questions until I was 29, and then I started asking questions. Where does this come from? How does it get here? How do they make it? And when I watched, I was like, I don't approve of this.
Yes, that's true.
You know, even in the nicest, happiest farm, like, I have some people that say you have three options, right? One, you have, let's just say two options, right? You have an animal that's been tortured, it's been abused his whole life, you know, or you have an animal that's super happy, they love their life, they had an amazing life. Which one do you kill? And it's like, the abused one is like the factory farmed one.
Yes.
And it's like, with that one, maybe you want to put him out of his misery
because
he's being tortured.
Yes.
But then you have people say that, oh, well, the animal lived a good life. Well, that's even more.
But how do you decide that because they lived a good life, they have to die?
That's even more of a disservice because they trust you. They trust us, you know, as their protector. And we're gonna take them. And I always say, well, what about a third option? Neither.
Yeah.
Just pay for neither. And so when people say, are you on a diet or anything like that? I'm not on a diet at all. I literally eat anything I want, everything I want. I don't want to eat dead animals. But more importantly, I don't want to pay those industries that do that because our money supports it.
That's
it's like
true.
Voting with your money, right? You say, I buy this, I support it. If I don't buy that, I don't support it, right?
That's
same
true.
With your company. If I buy your products, I support you.
Yeah, of course.
I support
of
your
course.
Products.
And you,
my,
so
your
you
money,
make me produce more.
You make you produce more
so,
because I'm telling you I
exactly.
want more. If I take the money away from your company, you wouldn't produce anything.
Yes,
if there was no money coming
true.
In, you wouldn't produce. It's all supply and demand.
It's like fur. Please stop buying fur or wearing it.
Yeah, that's a whole nother topic for sure.
I cannot see that anymore.
That's a whole nother topic because of, I mean, that's easy to connect with it being not necessary.
Yes.
It's for most people, fur is an easy connection.
Yes.
Meat or cheese or eggs is not an easy connection.
No, it's not.
Because people think they need it. When you take away the need and you realize you don't need it.
That's true.
Right? On a normal basis, right? People don't need it, right? A survival situation, absolutely.
Yes.
If I was in the woods and I was dying, there was an animal, I'd probably take his life, right? But I'm not in that situation.
No, you're not.
And so I understand survival situations, absolutely. People say thousands of years, you know, we needed to eat meat. I agree. You're probably right. Thousands of years, we probably had to survive.
Yes.
Right. In the winters when there was no vegetation and refrigeration and that sort of stuff. Absolutely. But now, like, I don't think there is an excuse anymore. And it's getting easier. It's getting easier.
It is, you know, because
especially with places like you, you're making it easier. Your company.
We're
is making
trying.
It easier.
We're trying.
Yeah.
We hope that we're moving towards something sustainable.
Yeah.
But, you know, because I was thinking of something. My husband's cousin has been vegan for 3 years now. And he always tells me, he does everything he can to promote veganism and everything. And he tells me veganism, we always associate it to food. But it's also, because I spoke about fur and, you know, leather. He's really vegan to the extent where he doesn't wear animals.
Yeah.
So it's also that. But maybe this is another step.
Yeah, for sure.
That people can take.
Well, some people say that. If you're just dieting, but you're wearing fur or leather or whatever, that's plant-based.
Yes.
You're on a plant-based diet.
Okay.
Right?
So you're not vegan.
You're not vegan, right?
Okay.
But if you're vegan, right, then that means that you as far as practical possible. Yeah, you try to cause the least amount of harm as practically possible.
Okay.
Right. So a true vegan, right? Like for me, example, like if I'm looking for shoes, I'm gonna look for one that doesn't have any leather.
Yes.
You know, because I know I don't need that. Yes. Right. Or I mean, I've never worn fur, so I can't compare that. Right. I don't understand that.
Yes.
But like even for toothpaste or for shampoos or whatever, like I'll look for the ones that are cruelty free.
Okay.
And then when I was first searching that, I was like, cruelty free.
But
like,
how do you find that in the supermarket?
So it can be challenging at times, but there's apps. There's apps that you can find. Okay. One is called iHerb.
Yes, I use it a lot.
Yeah, I think you could find products there that are cruelty-free. But even like a place like The Body Shop.
Okay.
You know, The Body Shop.
Yes.
They don't test on animals.
Okay.
As an example.
Okay.
So when I started looking into that, and I was like, okay, well, I don't want to pay for animal testing, but what does that mean? I watched videos about animal testing.
Okay.
I was reading a book called Animal Liberation, which talked about animal testing.
Okay.
And it opened my mind into, oh my God, that's like worse than factory farming,
it's
is what
horrible.
They do to animals. Because I've seen videos where they take dogs, okay?
Okay.
Dogs. And they force them to have a mask and they pump cigarette smoke into them. Until they die.
Oh my God.
And that's for testing for cigarettes.
Until
right?
they die?
Until they die. Yeah. And so every animal that gets tested on gets killed. All of them. So.
But not only gets killed.
They get tortured before
tortured
they get killed.
Before.
Yeah. But even if the torturing isn't as bad, right? There's have no use for them. They're like, I'm done with you testing. And now you're done. And there's technology now today that they could use. That they don't need animal testing. They can eliminate the animal testing right now. They have computers that actually do better, more accurate testing
than animals.
Than using animals, right? But there's funding. People get paid. It's a business.
Yes.
Animal testing is actually a business. It's crazy. So when I found that out, I will look for options that don't test on animals or cruelty free. Does it mean it's easy? No. But are they out there? Yeah.
You can make the effort.
You can find them
looking.
And make the effort.
Okay.
It just took us a couple videos of watching what happens and reading a book that had a section about it to make me open my mind that I don't want to support that.
Okay.
So it's very interesting kind of subject that you could look into, especially for those that care about animals, especially like you. If you knew you wouldn't want to pay for it.
No, of course not.
And that's what it's all about.
Yes.
It's just like, I don't want to pay for that. I can pay for something else. Right.
Yeah.
That maybe does the same job.
And I guess that's the thing. We have to be reminded of it all the time.
Yeah. Even the beginning, when I first went, it was hard because American culture eats more meat per person, more kilograms, right, in meat than any other culture.
It's true.
Right? And so what that means is my conditioning was so strong. And I was just a normal, average American diet, you know, typical. And so I had to remind myself, if I don't want to pay for this, I have to just watch what happens.
Yes,
so if I wanted some chicken or crave some chicken, I would watch how they treat chickens.
Yes.
Or if I wanted some bacon, I would watch that. And eventually, one, I learned what happens. And two, it helped me almost not condition myself into vegan, but condition my unconditioned, like unbrainwashed.
Yes, yes.
I
and
was
have
brainwashed.
A new
perspective. Yeah,
perspective.
Exactly. Because I made a decision not to pay for it. But now I had to make that commitment. So I had to align my beliefs that were already there. I was born with these beliefs that I never could harm a dog or a cat.
Of course.
Right? I remember crying when I seen my cat die when I was a kid.
Yes.
And so I knew that the beliefs were there inside. I just had to align my actions, you know, and just figure out how to get my actions to align with my beliefs.
That's true. It's an everyday job, honestly. Yeah. Because to unbreak the habits that you've had since you were born is not easy.
Yeah, absolutely.
You have to recondition yourself.
Well, I think we'll wrap this up. The last thing I usually ask is if there's just one thing that you want the listeners or the viewers to know or to remember, what would that be? If there's one thing that you just don't want them to forget.
Well, I think what I wouldn't want them to forget is... But the planet that we're leaving for our kids, for the future generations.
Yeah.
And I think it's like, you know, it's like using a space or renting a house. You have to take care of it.
Yeah, it's
you
a
have,
good analogy. Or you pay.
Or you pay the price.
Yeah.
So I think our bodies are like this, and we're affecting the world around us. And we have to realize that nature is not ours to take. So we have to treat it well.
It's borrowed time. We're borrowing it.
Exactly.
And we want to leave it better for the next generation.
At the end, we are living in nature. We took it away to build our houses. So we should maybe always remember that we're not alone, and to think about the rest.
Oh, that's a really good message.
I think that's important. Yes.
I like that. Well, thank you so much for your time. Thank you for your hospitality. Thank you for the delicious desserts.
Thank you for contacting us.
Yeah, absolutely. And I look forward to you seeing this in the future. And
I can't wait. Already I can't wait.
And look forward to hopefully working together with you maybe in the future.
We hope. We really hope.
Thank you. Gotta make a change. It's time for us as a people to start making some changes. Let's change the way we eat. Let's change the way we live, and let's change the way we treat each other. You see, the old way wasn't working, so it's on us to do what we gotta do.